I have some guests here today who speak English, so I will do this 30-minute speech in English. I trust that it's okay with all of you. You will also not have to hear all of my horrible mistakes in Finnish after only speaking Swedish for the majority of my working days for the past 4 years. My name is Emma Storbacka. I'm the CEO of Avaus. I've been with Avaus for the past soon 8 years, and today I will talk about a topic which is very close to our hearts, which is how you turn data into results and how you do it at speed. And data into results has to do with artificial intelligence. I know you've heard a lot about this topic already today, and therefore I will try to be as concrete as possible and also give you some hints on what you need to take back with you from all of the inspirational cases, ranging all the way from Formula Ones to retail and personalization of customer experiences. Shortly about Avaus, we've been around for quite a few years already, and all this time we have been about turning data into results. It could be about creating top line, and typically that's where we come in. We help our customers doing marketing, sales, service, customer experiences, where either growing top line through getting more customers in B2C or B2B, increasing the spend of those customers, or improving the customer experience and the loyalty. But AI and data can also be used for improving efficiency. And I think that part should not be forgotten in the kind of economic situation we are in today, where an economic recession might be around the corner. And reflecting a bit on where we're coming from, so I think most of you know us from kind of MarTech, marketing automation, implementing new digital channels, which was all the rage kind of for the last 10 years. And that's been keeping us busy. We brought the term growth hacking into the Nordics in 2014, being the first one starting to talk about growth teams. We already felt it was kind of a kind of old concept, but has really kind of taken off in the last few years here in the Nordics. And today, a lot of the work we do in advisory and in implementation is around data and analytics. Now, why is that? Well, I think through most of the presentations today, you've heard about the problematics of scaling personalization, about scaling relevancy, about outsourcing decisioning and testing to algorithms. In order for us to take the next steps and compete with kind of highly personalized customer experiences provided by Facebook or Netflix or Amazon or Alibaba, we have to dive into the area of analytics, and we have to leverage that through the process of growth hacking and into our marketing technology stacks. We work mainly with big customers that have a transformational agenda, and we have already been delivering a really large range of kind of AI-first type of projects, a lot in machine learning, a lot in customer and experience analytics. So who of you feel that your work has becoming easier lately? No one. It's very kind of complex, the world we live in. We have more channels, we have more choice, there might be an economic recession coming, how to balance that with needed investments. The speed of change is increasing, and we are faced with more and more decisions every day when it comes to how to manage our customers. So it's not getting any easier. So imagine if you would be able to derive insights and data from all of the rich experiences around you, from voice and video and customer interactions in any channel. Imagine if all of the decisions regarding what offer or channel or how much to spend could be done automatically. Or imagine if you would be able to offer a fully personalized experience that really matters to your customer in any interface. Well, all of that is possible. And it's really about execution. technology has enabled us to do all of these things at a much faster pace than before. And it's our jobs to make sure that we keep up with that development. Artificial intelligence might sound like a very complex topic, and leveraging data for your customer experience to a greater extent than today is a big and kind of scary target. But I think it's really kind of key to boil down what artificial intelligence should be doing for you. And for example, starting with this list and looking pretty creatively on your full customer management process and identifying where could we be more relevant? What are kind of the big meetings with our customer? Where can we make better decisions regarding tactics or offers or regarding media spend and channels? Or even the services that we offer to our customers? Where can we automate the things that we are doing manually today? Especially, I think, in the area of content and marketing collateral production, there is probably 40 to 80% efficiency gains to be made if we just go and do it. And then finally, how do we bring more transparency and trust in what we are doing? Data is the most important currency, but how carefully are you managing that your customers feel that you really are getting something back for the data you supply? Machine learning and AI will also help you open up all of that backbone and all of that data that you've collected and all of the experiences that you create with the data will kind of give the sign off for the customer that it was worth swiping that card every time, or it was worth accepting those cookies on the website. And with GDPR, we have to think about this. So the AI agenda, I think, should be about both creating growth, but also efficiency. And of course, if combined, we can achieve more growth with less resources or the same level with what we have today. So what would then some of these AI-driven experiences look like? I think you could cluster them into a few different ways of looking at a data-driven or AI-driven customer experience. And I think we see way too few of these in Finland and in the Nordics today. A moment that really kind of paid off all of the data I have been giving Google for about the last 7 years was when I was in Malmö and I looked for a place to drink coffee. Never had I been in Malmö before. I opened Google Maps and was just basically looking for, you know, where is the city center? So I looked, you know, up cafes. And in Google Maps, it actually brought up a recommendation that was called Noir Cafe. And it said, I have a 70% potential of liking this place. Now, this moment really kind of brought to me a sensation of, wow, this is what AI-driven experiences are about. So I have been giving all of my location data to Google for 7 years, and I've never gotten anything back. But this single moment made me stop questioning whether I should continue actually, you know, giving off everything I do and my privacy to Google, because the convenience that I got in this second was enormous. The cafe, by the way, was excellent. It was just the kind of cafe that I would visit in Stockholm. So, of course, the algorithm here behind is looking at what sort of person am I, what sort of people visit this cafe, and how do they match together? What's my likelihood of actually liking it? Now, if you apply that to, for example, retail, we do a lot of work with grocery retail. And analytics as an engine of your customer experience becomes incredibly important. So imagine not only knowing which products you want to offer next because I might buy them, but actually helping me create my buying list every day or subscribing to food in the future. That's an incredibly powerful service that I get back for having given that feedback or that data to a big retail corporation. The other aspect is then the glue. So we all know that you don't give away your Netflix account to anyone else because it's going to mess up your algorithm. If I have built my convenient lifestyle on the fact that ICA, for example, knows what I'm going to buy next, will I ever go and buy olive oil at Coop, knowing that it will mess up my algorithm? It creates an incredible glue for me and my customer relationship in a business where frequency and loyalty is key. So kind of building some value from that algorithm becomes key. Now, these are all kind of great examples of fantastic experiences, but the really kind of easy win is just in marketing efficiency. So outsourcing a bit of the decisions around media spend or channel spend to algorithms will help all of us do a much better job with the resources we have today. And the great stuff with algorithmic approaches to, for example, media spend or channels, is that the effect will be not only incremental, but exponential. So you should be looking at things you can do where you can increase your output tenfold, not 10%. And if you start looking at all the things you do and where a tenfold improvement would make a lot of sense, that's probably where you want to start your roadmap. Now, what about these different kind of AI topics? There are so many ways that you could approach this. We have a lot of different technologies saying that there's AI inbuilt, but we also have the data scientists saying that, no, we'll build that ourselves. The best way to approach this is a balanced kind of hybrid approach. We sometimes talk about big brain analytics and small brain analytics, just to differentiate between kind of what you would want to use in a licensed solution versus what is really strategic for you long-term in your company. And I'm going to show you an example of some small brain analytics shortly. I've copied the wrong text there. So the big brain is where you would typically do very strategic decisioning around your customer strategy. Which are the customers we want to grow? Which are the customers that will churn? What is the next best action in a big sense? Do we want to sell, serve, or retain? Where is our future potential? And what's the full orchestration of the customer experience around those business targets? Now, in your small brain analytics, it could be about optimizing content on the website. I think the example from Yle was fantastic. So which of the pictures will convert the best? Or what timing should we have when we send out an email? And in between, you will have, of course, all kinds of packaged solutions and black box analytics. But I think the important thing is to realize you will need both. You shouldn't be developing your own algorithm for, let's say, timings of emails, if that can be offered by Salesforce Einstein. But again, you shouldn't maybe build all of your AI strategy within only one domain and one solutions provider. Different technologies will also bring different types of use cases that we can use. And I think the development within deep learning, meaning that the data we actually apply analytics to and derive intelligence from, can be richer. And I think one of the key takeaways for formulating your data science or advanced analytics or AI strategy should really be about thinking about what is actually data. So even speaking with some of our customers that have the most data in Sweden or Finland, retailers, telcos, insurance companies, banks, typically don't have enough data. And if you think about that, 90% of all of the world's data was created in the last few years, that typically is not the case with the data that you have in your companies. And it mainly has to do with the fact that you aren't collecting rich data. Videos, images, speech from your customer service, email content or chat content, all of those things that deep learning algorithms will help you also turn into insights. Facial recognition, not only clicks on a website, for instance. And the thing with deep learning and all of this rich data is that you're going to want to have historical data so that you can train your algorithms. So thinking about what data you will need 2 years from now makes a lot of sense. So when you have that data, and most companies have quite a lot of data, if you have any sort of business and if you are sending invoices, you have enough data to start doing quite advanced analytical and AI development. Now, the big question and the most strategic must-win for your development roadmap within CRM or CX or marketing is really kind of figuring out how do you connect all of the data that typically is stored in some sort of enterprise data warehouse in your system of records level. It could be in your CRM, it could be in your ERP. And how do you connect all of that with your engagement layer, so your MarTech and AdTech and your website and your apps and your point of sales, the place where your customers meet you. And what typically has been the first step when you've been starting to work with MarTech is that you build a lot of the logic into the engagement layer. So that is where you decide who gets what when. There's where you build your triggers, or that's where you create your segmentations. Now, what we all see now is when we try to scale that, it becomes a really fragmented customer experience. And you typically have channel silos. So you might have a next best action model working only in one of those because it's rules-based and created based on, for example, only web data. At the same time, you might be calling the customer service and not being seeing anything that reflects that historical behavior. So creating the intelligence layer in between is really, really key. And it's in the let's say, interface between the intelligence layer and your MarTech layer or engagement layer where the magic really happens. And I would claim that most likely very few of you in the room have a sufficient intelligence layer connected to your engagement layer. And this is a big, big win if you get it right. Because that means that you then can start scaling up all of your AI and data initiatives into all of your customer interfaces. And that's where it's going to have some power. One example of a very simple kind of small brain analytics thing, which I think also we should all start working with immediately. Most of you have some sort of marketing automation system. Most of you have some sort of website. And most of you do some sort of biddable media. All of those are fantastic channels to start experimenting with AI and machine learning. And this is an example with one fashion retailer that has an online store and an offline store network using Salesforce Einstein, just kind of getting started on the analytical journey and the AI journey to create more relevant product recommendations. And in this case, doing that using deep learning, so looking at images, clustering them, and finding out what sort of style actually is interesting for each and every customer that has made purchases or visited the website before. Now, this is a very simple example where we can find different sorts of style clusters. So some people are the very classical blue and white shirt, and some people like the flamboyant, let's say, colorful or patterned shirts. But once we have this in place, scaling that up into all of those mentioned channels will have an immediate effect. And these are things that are not difficult to do. It's just about leveraging the tools that you already have. So for instance, if you're sitting on a Salesforce Marketing Cloud instance, why not start your algorithmic journey right there while planning for the longer strategy? So coming out of this day, how should you think about your AI agenda and turning all of the data that you have into results at speed, but also in a way which creates long-term strategic value for you? And I think there are two ways that we see this being done, the other one being the successful one. But I think the first one could be described as AI FOMO, fear of missing out. So I'm going to show you three things. If you recognize them, it means you might have a little bit of a AI FOMO strategy in your organization. And then I'm going to show you what it means if you start thinking about long-term strategic development where you build capability over time and win out over your competition while doing that. So FOMO, for those of you not familiar, is really kind of a description of a feeling where you go everywhere because you don't want to miss out. And all of our social media use and being kind of connected all the time, of course, is described here as well. The first sign that you have a kind of FOMO-based strategy is that there is a swamp of POCs, POCs. Your data science team all the time has something new and cool that they're working on, but very few of those things actually ever go into production. We are doing a lot in AI, kind of is a thing that is nice to say, but if what you're doing in AI is a lot of POCs, then you might be kind of taking the wrong approach. And there are many reasons for this, but one is that there is no clear business vision, and the other is that there is no clear technical vision for where we want to go, which results in a big list of experiments. The other sign is that you have a data science team which has an average tenure of 1 year. So data scientists are the most difficult ones to recruit, trust me. But what makes them stick is if they get interesting work to do that actually is going somewhere. I've seen a lot of organizations investing really high numbers in getting new data scientists into the team, but not really knowing what to do to them. So you throw some data at them and say, you know, come up with something nice, maybe a POC. And they do so, and they're pretty inspired for maybe 4 months. Then they start realizing that the patchwork of technology and the kind of lack of interest and demand from marketing or CX or sales makes it really, really difficult to actually learn anything. Because if you only do POCs, you're basically not developing your skills. And then they get frustrated, and then they leave. It's a lot of fun for a short time, and you might be doing some cool stuff, but it's actually creating no value whatsoever, because anything that might have been created for the organization, of course, also leaves with these guys going out to the next place where they get 1,000 euros more per month. The problem with these guys, of course, is as well that the phone is ringing every week, so it's very, very easy for them to kind of move on. And we need to also realize when we are not doing a good enough job of getting kind of interesting work that matters. And then the last kind of proof point, if having a FOMO strategy is something you're scared of or thinking of that might be the case, is if you are kind of making purchasing decisions on all kinds of marketing apps or kind of data apps that have kind of AI included. And it's a great thing. They should all probably have that. Although some research shows that 50% of startups that claim to be AI actually aren't. But I think one really key takeaway is that there are lots of them. They are great. We made actually a landscape of it, which you can see on our website. And many of them do great things, but having one of these is still not going to be having an AI strategy or being AI-driven in marketing or customer management. So when talking with customers, I would claim that in the Nordics, there are very few companies that actually would be amongst the 6% which have AI in use or deployed today, a handful. And all of those, I would claim, are startups or companies like Spotify. So we are, most of us, likely not doing enough. If we are doing a lot, that as well will probably need to continue for quite some time. So my challenge to you is, during this year, make your algorithmic roadmap. Have a vision and be certain that your organization around you understands what the future will need to look like. Don't need to do all of the big and complex stuff, but get started and start to define those use cases end to end. That's how you will ensure that you kind of take the first steps and don't get caught after your competition or the global competition, who surely are way ahead of us here. And finally, kind of staying humble. I think none of us are able to say that we do enough in this area. So kind of keep hungry, and keep learning in this space, that's where the results come. Thank you.